I want to thank you for the inspiration you have been to all of us.
My Chinese name is Bei Yue Ming, and my Americanized name is initial IM, stand for Yue Ming. So I am Bei now, because it's simple.
I am Bei is one of the greatest modern architects of our time. Known for designing the Louvre Museum in Paris, France, the Bank of China Tower in Hong Kong, the Suzhou Museum in Suzhou, China, and countless other architectural treasures. He is a scholar and a visionary who has inspired countless generations with a legacy even more well-known than the buildings he's designed.
He was really very well-known, integrated himself into American society while still retaining the pride of being a Chinese representative. So he was always like a beacon to all Chinese Americans. And he actually, you know, he came earlier, and yet he made a huge success of his career and his identity.
IM was born on April 26, 1917 in Guangzhou, China. As a youth, he grew up admiring the architecture of Shanghai, and on August 13, 1935, at the age of 17, Bei boarded the steamship SS President Coolidge and sailed to the United States to study architecture. 2 weeks later, he arrived at Angel Island on August 28, 1935, with a student visa, and upon approval of his paperwork, took a train to Philadelphia to start his studies at the University of Pennsylvania.
I came as a student. I was treated so well, really amazingly well, especially by the professors. And I couldn't speak English when I first came, so I had the chance to learn by association. And American friends helped me a lot.
When he arrived at the University of Pennsylvania, he discovered the architecture program was not what he had expected. Bei was fascinated by modern architecture and therefore decided to transfer to the Massachusetts Institute of Technology.
And when I was in college, I felt very privileged that people were interested in me. Rather than discriminating against me, they wanted to know more about who I was and who I am.
These first experiences in America would sow the seeds for what would become a lifelong mission to incorporate Bei's Chinese identity into his career, his adopted home in the U.S., and later to bridge U.S.-China relations. After school, IM attempted to return to China, but World War II prevented his departure. This would turn out to be another pivotal, life-changing moment. On a trip visiting New York City, Bei met Eileen Liu, a Wellesley College student. They began dating and later married in the spring of 1942. They eventually had four children, two of whom became architects like their father. In 1942, a month into his graduate school enrollment, Bei suspended his work at Harvard to join the National Defense Research Committee, which produced scientific research on U.S. weapons technology during World War II. This proved his patriotism and deepened his connection to the United States.
If you know the man, he is a man of great sensitivity, man of very, very perceptive understanding of the counterparty, the other person, and truly interested in what you have to say and your point of view. And ultimately, from what Mr. Bei used to tell me, it is even reflected in his work.
Bei's first successful major project was a two-story building for Gulf Oil in Atlanta, Georgia, built in 1949.
I'm an architect, that's all, and not much more, but I'm a Chinese-American architect.
In 1954, he became a U.S. citizen. A year later, Bei opened his own New York-based architecture firm, IM Bei & Associates, which eventually became Bei, Cobb, Fried & Partners in 1989.
IM at that time was running one of the largest architectural firms in the country. When I first met him, he opened the door and he showed me a room with 300 working architects. It was a drafting room with 300 people on drafting boards. And he was working on maybe a half a dozen major skyscrapers, famous buildings all around the world.
Bei has created some of the most influential buildings in the world, including the Louvre Museum in Paris, France, the John Hancock Building in Boston, the East Wing of the National Gallery, as well as the new Chinese Embassy in the U.S. In 1964, he was chosen by Jacqueline Kennedy to design the John F. Kennedy Library at Harvard University.
The idea that talent and commitment and hard work could achieve such very high results, we all looked up to him for that reason.
It's up to you, New York, New York, New York.
In 1983, Pei was awarded the Pritzker Prize, which is often called the Nobel Prize of Architecture. He was also awarded the Presidential Medal of Freedom by President George H.W. Bush in 1992. IM has achieved fame in architecture and politics, but he's also known for having an undeniable determination and passion for everything in life.
He said, "I want fireworks." Well, all the government people said, "Look, we're in a very heavily populated area. No way can we do fireworks. It's a fire hazard, it's a noise hazard." And he kept on saying, "I really want fireworks."
My job is always to seek out new restaurants that to introduce him to, especially Chinese restaurants.
He then built this kind of structure just from rods, and he wound these firework tapes through that. So they weren't, in quotes, fireworks, but it was this firework tape.
We brought him to a place that took a lot of, had to drive an hour to get there and everything else. And I thought this was going to be a really great place, as you say, eating dumplings.
And at the end of the show, after our performance finished, Tsai Gua-chang lit the thing. And the fireworks tape went through the whole thing and went up this thing and burst into flames.
And after a few bites, IM said, "The cook must be."
So that's IM. When he has an idea, somehow he's going to find a way to get it done. He got his fireworks.
In 1987, fate struck. Pei and Henry Kissinger met at a black tie event, setting the stage for a lifelong friendship.
IM appeared in my life when I started being active in the government, when he called on me at a time before relations had been established about the importance of China to the world.
At that event, Kissinger and Pei exchanged stories about working in China and their shared journey as immigrants rising as leaders in America. Dr. Kissinger encouraged Pei to consider organizing Chinese Americans like himself to address issues of international concern between the United States and China.
Tiananmen, I think, it happened. And I think Americans at that time were really somewhat confused about what was happening. In fact, I was too. So in that sense, I think a few of us thought that we should take a position and try to explain.
Pei began to heed Kissinger's advice and turn his focus to reaching out to and convening Chinese Americans to discuss what had occurred in China.
He was the one person, perhaps, in the Chinese American community who had the capability to convene such a meeting.
It was the beginning of something, and I think we seem to have struck some kind of a chord that seemed to be resonate. And a lot of people are curious about what's happening. Since 1989, that interest has multiplied.
By the end of 1990, the core group had recruited 40 other distinguished Chinese Americans from the arts, business, academia, public service, and the sciences to serve on the committee.
Even though he had been in America for so long, he was deeply upset by what happened in China. Even though he frankly wasn't that close to China because he had been gone for so long, and had some involvement, not that much. So he really helped kind of guide us to make sure that we really put this group together for the future that would really look at U.S.-China relations and to try and help in that regard.
In 1994, Pei led a delegation to China, where a half dozen committee members met with Chinese President Jiang Zemin to discuss the state of U.S.-China relations and share an American perspective.
Everyone's work is very, very important and contributes to the fabric of being Chinese in America and able to make a contribution.
Pei planted roots in the U.S. more than 80 years ago. His legacy flourishes with the 4 children, 7 grandchildren, and 4 great-grandchildren who are building Chinese-American narratives of their own.
my children, my grandchildren particularly, they're becoming more and more Americans. The Chinese root is there, but how close could they get to that root? They should become American, they are. But I also want them to know that they came from somewhere that has a long history behind it. I know the history, but they don't. I think they have to learn about it themselves. I hope time will come that I hope that they will realize that, yes, I want to know. It will come, I think.
I am Pei as a scholar, a visionary, an inspiration to us all. The world will continue to admire and experience his legacy of masterful works. We all owe a debt of gratitude to I Am Pei for trailblazing a path as a young Chinese immigrant in America who rose to fame as one of the world's most prolific architects. He continues to define greatness through creativity.
I came as a Chinese, I remain as a Chinese, but now I'm American Chinese.
Happy 100th birthday, I Am. Thank you for all that you've done for all of us, from all of us.